Salutations, good morning. What's up? This is Chris Erskine, Pastor E, affectionately known in the movement. Grateful to God for another opportunity to share with you and yours as we are in this new season, new year, 2024. Grateful to God for absolutely everything that he is providing for us. Many of you have been asking, Pastor E, you never say anything proselyte about the church. Well, what we wanted to do was make sure that we brought you quality content and share with you information that could better you and yours. Our church is the Movement Fellowship Church, 1140 Pratt Highway. We're in the beautiful section of the Pratt City, Sandusky, Forestdale, Adamsville area of our city. We have one church in multiple states, so if you're in New York, you ought to check us out. If you're in Cleveland, Ohio, soon we'll have a Cleveland, Ohio campus and fellowship. We're looking for other fellowships across the country where we have pockets of parishioners and believers who are connected to us. You can tune in with us not only on the CW21 every Saturday morning or our YouTube channel, TMFC Live, where you can get all kind of content about the movement and about the ministry and all that God has for us. Solve all, last but not least, our TMFCLive.com website is all things movement. Anything you need clarity on, go to TMFCLive, L-I-V-E.com. You can pick it up there at our home on the web. So this morning, we are 3 weeks now in. This is your fourth Saturday, fourth installment on New Year, New You. My question is, how are you doing? How are you doing with those resolutions? How are you doing with those resolutions? Have you made it to the gym yet? Are you still on course? Are you losing the weight that you want? Have you read the 15 books that you said you were going to do? All these lofty, lofty resolutions we make at the beginning of the year because everybody's making them. Well, sit back this morning. I want to share some things with you about making the shift from resolutions to revelation. And making this shift, you're going to see some amazing things happen in your life. I'll be right back after this. Back. I'm thankful for the opportunity to share with you and yours. I bless God that week one we dealt with discipline. And if you are going to be a new you in a new year, you got to get disciplined. One of the things about discipline that gets to my mind is lifting weights. I never liked to do it when we were in high school, but I had to do it because of the position that I played. And we had weight training. And that weight training, every last one of us had to bench press. We had cycles and different sets we had to do. But at the end of the day, you had to hit that bench press. And whenever you hit that bench press, they put on all the weight that you say you could possibly lift. And everybody crowded around to see if you could push that weight. There were no haters in the room. There was nobody who was hoping that you fail because we were all one team. And everybody was cheering you on. But here is the litmus test for us all. It wasn't the weight that we were under. It wasn't the bench we were sitting on. The discipline for us was the spotter standing over us. That person who was strong enough that no matter what the weight was on the bar, they could help lift it off of you. So whether it was 300, 400, 600, 800, whatever it was, and you got it off of the bar and pulled it down, when it was time to push it up, all of us was going crazy. Go, go, go. And then the spotter was in place, not to help you lift it, but to make sure that they were in place, that if you couldn't, that it wouldn't hurt you. That's what discipline does. Discipline acts as your spotter to get in place, to make sure you don't hurt yourself trying to lift life's weight on your own, trying to lift depression by yourself, trying to lift sorrow by yourself, trying to parent by yourself, trying to take care of your parents in their senior years by yourself, trying to be that single parent, making it without knowing where the ends are going to meet. That spiritual spotter is discipline that jumps in to help lift that load for you. But not only discipline, we talked about dedication. What good is to be disciplined if you're not going to be dedicated? It's one thing to lift weights once a year, but to be dedicated, you got to lift weights every week, every other day. Our son, he works out. He tells me today, Dad, is leg day. And all he does is works on his legs and his lower extremities, core and lower body frame. Then there are arm days that he just works on his arms. And I'm excited to see the dedication that he gives. I don't care if we're on vacation. I don't care if I'm on assignment, if we're out of state, out of the country. He's going to bring what he needs to make sure that he stays dedicated to his workout regimen. Well, that's his workout regimen. What's your spiritual regimen? He has one of those where he's studying and reading. Our daughter has the same. But my question is, what do you have? What do you have daily that you are dedicated to that's building your spirit man, building your inner man, that's helping you emotionally, that's helping you to deal with life's heavy load? What are you dedicated to? Watch this. That is bringing more to you than taking away from you. There are so many things in life taking from you. The question is, what are you doing dedicated that's bringing more to you? So we talked about discipline. We talked about dedication. Last week, we hit hard with determination. Well, Pastor E, I thought dedication was determination. Well, you could be dedicated to something and lose all the determinant will to continue to press forward. You could be dedicated even in going down. I saw people dedicated in defeat. I was watching the NFL playoffs and wondering, why in the world are these teams still with 30 seconds, 40 seconds on the clock, and they down by 20, 30 points, still playing hard because they're determined. They're determined that they won't give up until the last snap. And can I tell you, you're giving up in the first quarter. You're giving up at halftime. You're taking off all your pads, and you put everything up as if the game is over because you're down. Even if there are seconds left, you still are in the game. I don't care what the scoreboard looks like. I don't care what people are telling you. If you continue to persevere through determination, nothing is impossible to you. I want to pray that that spiritual avenger in you emerges to push back whatever is pushing against you, not to have the resolve and the mindset to do the things in life that you are determined, but to have the peace and the understanding that only comes from being disciplined, dedicated, and determined by God. As I share these moments with you, this new year has brought on so many different angles of life that we weren't ready for. 2024, for us, it's a year of expansion. I said this in teaching past, that if I can purchase a 2024 automobile in 2023, why is it that I can't have 2024 blessings in 2023? So our church took on the mindset that our calendar year, it doesn't end in January, end in December and begin in January. For us, it's October to October. And so when Oktoberfest ended and we went into a brand new year, we started to experience the power of expansion. We began to expand not only in property and people, but we began to experience expansion even in purpose. God allowed us to undertake more things and to do more things and to have more things because to whom much is given, much is required. We understood in the year of expansion that God was looking at our purpose as a church to see what was most important to us. Matthew 25, 35 became diligent to us. It became our devotion. So if you are going to move from discipline to dedication to determination, you must become devoted. Devoted meaning that no matter what in life is presented, I'm going to stay diligent. I'm going to stay determined. I'm going to stay disciplined. I'm going to stay dedicated. I'm going to stay devoted to this thing to see it into fruition. And so over the next few minutes, I want to take a deeper dive into devotion and show you the difference between devotion and ego. Determination has all to do with having a resolute mindset to do something. But dedication is a strong feeling or caring, loyalty, and love for something. Are you battling between devotion and ego? Ego is the main obstacle to intimacy. Intimacy opens the door with God to provide for you the things that you never would ever experience. The closer you get to Him, the closer He gets to you. The devotion that you have with Him, the time that you cut aside and share with no one else, but it is exclusively His, is what God is looking for. That's what's happening on these 21 days of prayer and fasting that we started on the 10th of January and we go through the 31st. Is it hard? Yes. Do we get hungry? Yes. Do we have cravings? Yes. Do we have desires? Yes. Do we want to do some of the things that we have naturally given up, the natural pleasures? Yes. But it is the devotion. One of our parishioners sent me a DM and he said, Pastor E, I had to pull a 48-hour shift due to the storm. And I wasn't home to get my meals prepped for the fast like I normally do. So I had to binge and I had to eat outside of the purview of the fast. What do I do? I say, you've already did it. You stayed committed and devoted to the fast. And because you stayed devoted to the fast, don't worry about the miscues. Don't worry about the stumbles along the way. It is the devotion that God is looking for. Outside of the stopping of the natural pleasure, are you increasing your spirituality? Are you reading more of His word? Are you listening to lives like this? Are you playing, going back, going to replay? Are you studying more? Are you allowing the word Bible apps to read to you? Are you listening to more gospel music than you are secular? Some transition needs to happen in your life to reveal that devotion. Well, devotion protects instead of shares. Its intimate relationship is a spiritual practice. This is deeply humbling in work. Devotion, commitment, cherishing, honoring. This is the very little room left for your ego to come in and the energies thereof. Distractions are the greatest enemies to your devotion. Say that one more time, Pastor E. Distractions are the greatest enemies to your devotion. I want you to push back on all of the distractions that are coming in your life, the little spiritual gnats and flies that are flying around your situation and purpose. Rather than wadding them away and hitting them away, I want you to stay diligent. I want you to stay determined on the goal and the devotion that is called for so that you can persevere and have a understanding of what God has in store for you. Can I tell you, when you focus on the big picture, staying focused of what you want is always easy when it is in view. It is when it's out of view that you're going to have the hardest time. You're going to have to make up in your mind that I got to keep my focus on the bigger picture. Because if I allow the strays and the situations and the little circumstances that come along with life to derail me, distract me, my devotion has been hijacked. Remember, distractions are the greatest enemies to your devotion. Say that with me. Distractions are the greatest enemies to your devotion. Stay devoted. I'll be back in a few minutes to share two or three more things with you we'll close out for the day. Devotion. Devotion is key to rounding out new year, new you. You've given them discipline. You've given them determination. You've given them dedication. Here is devotion. How do you summarize this, Pastor E? Make it applicable for us. Give us life application. Give us an illustration. There were three little boys who grew up in upper New York State. And a gentleman came to them and said, I will give the winner of out of all three of you, the one who wins the race, I'll give you a crisp $100 bill. The gentleman reached in his pocket and pulled over his wallet, reached in and started peeling through $100 bills, peeled one out. He says, I'll give the runner this $100 bill. All three boys got excited. They start jumping around. They start talking about what they were going to buy. One said, I'm going to buy me a PlayStation game. One said, I'm going to buy me an Xbox game. The other one said, I'm going to take mine and save it. But they all were excited. The gentleman said, here's the catch. Whoever runs the straightest line will win. The $100 doesn't go to the winner who runs the fastest, but it is given to the one who runs the straightest line. The boys understood the instructions. They now are backing back to the starting gate. The gentleman walks off 100 yards, and he yells, go. And all the boys took off at the same time, and they are running. And they're running through the snow. As they're running through the snow, the first young man does not want the other two young men to outrun him. So he starts watching them. And as he's watching them, trying to keep pace above them, his line is being moved from side to side. It is not a straight line. Although he's leading, he's still losing because he's not obeying the instructions. The other young man is running the race, but he's so mindful on making the right steps, he's not looking up, he's looking down. And now he's making a straight line, but it's going different and opposite of where the gentleman is standing. The third young man takes out running, and he's running, and he's running, and he keeps his eyes on the gentleman at the end of the race. Because here's what he's thinking. If I'm going to run a straight line, I need to run it straight to the man. And he said it doesn't matter how fast I run, as long as the line is straight. As they enter into the race, they're halfway into it. There's still the young man who's in the lead. He is watching the other runners. The other young man who is in second has his head down watching his feet. And there it is, the third young man who is still teetering, but still last, keeping his eyes on the old man. And as they're running, and as they're running and trudging through the snow, here comes the crowd of neighbors out because they're trying to figure out why are these young boys so excited about running. To the gentleman says, the winner gets this crisp $100 bill. So now they're all cheering. One is cheering for the young man in the lead. Others are cheering for the young man who is second. Then the underdog. Everybody gets behind the underdog to push him forward. They all finish the race. Then the gentleman asks, who do you think won? The young man who was in first, who was out front and in the lead, he said, surely it was me. I beat both of them. I made sure that neither one of them outran me. He said, you're exactly right. Both boys dropped their head. He said, but you didn't win. He said, what do you mean I didn't win? I came in first. He said, remember, son, I told you that the race is not given to the swift or to the strong. But it is the one who endures to the end by following the instructions. Although you were first, your line, look back over it. The snow tells the tail. Look back over the snow path. The path tells the truth. Know how it is wobbling, it's moving from side to side all the way up? He said, yes, it's not as straight as it could have been. He looks at the second young man who came in second place. He says, surely I won because I kept watching my feet. I wasn't watching them. I was watching my feet. He said, you're right. You were watching your feet, and your line was straight. He said, but look where it took you. Look back at your path. And the path was straight, but it took him away from the old man. They said, well, there's no brainer. We know that he won. The third young man who came in third and last won. So the lesson of this story is not only how you're running, but what you're focused on. The first young man walked away as the third young gentleman got the $100 bill. He's shaking his head. He said, I just knew I was going to win. And the gentleman patted him on the shoulder and told him, listen, son, in life when you're running life's race, stop trying to keep up with everybody else. Stop trying to make sure that you're going to come in first. You won't even enjoy the race trying to make sure that your competition is always behind you. Just stay focused. If you stay focused, it doesn't matter who comes in first, second, or third, because you would have ran your best race. One of the amazing coaches that I have seen in these years past teaches his team never to look at the score during the game, because the scoreboard does not matter until all the time runs off the clock. At the end, when the time runs off the clock will reveal what you did best with your time. And I want to celebrate those of you who are running. But I want to say to you, are you running with focus? Are you devoted to the instructions? Are you running life's race without, watch this, having a mind for someone else? Are you always looking down the line, making sure that no one is beating you in the office? Are you always looking down the line, making sure somebody doesn't beat you in the neighborhood, that you got the best car and the best house and the best clothes and the best this and the best that, when ultimately that is not fulfillment in life? Life is not fulfilled with what you have on. Life is fulfilled with who you have within. And this young man learns a valuable lesson that he teaches each and every one of us, that you cannot pay attention to others while you're running your own race. That second young man was really distraught. He wanted an Xbox game. But because he kept looking down, watching his own feet, he couldn't win either. Can I tell you, his problem was not that he was watching everybody else, but he was too busy and too preoccupied with himself. And that's teaching for someone who's listening this morning on this lesson on devotion, that you are trying to keep up with life by being preoccupied with yourself. You have no mind about anything or nobody else, and in the situation, all you are captured with is you. You are enamored with your own steps and your own path and your own pursuit, your own trophies. Not understanding that you don't score touchdowns if no one blocks. You don't score three-pointers if no one is shooting a screen. You have to have the importance of knowing the other people in your life make a difference. But it is that last young man that I want to end on today, that he helps us to realize that if you're going to run the race, you don't have to be the fastest, and you don't have to be preoccupied with yourself. All you have to do is follow the instructions. He knew that if I keep my eyes on the gentleman, it doesn't matter how the other competitors are running. I'm not running their race. I'm running my race. I want to thank you this morning for sharing in with us. New year, new you. I want to pray with you that your devotion, not like that first runner who is keeping up with others, or that second runner who has his head down watching his own feet, but like that third young man who keeps his eyes focused squarely on the instructions and the goal. Can we pray this morning? Can you call the family in and those who are home with you, or perhaps those who are with you at this very moment? Let's go to God in prayer. Our Father, we love you and honor you and glorify you this day. You are the worthy one to be worshiped. And thank you for everything you provided for us. We wouldn't have if you didn't provide. So we thank you now for all that you have done, all you're doing, and all you have promised to do for each and every one of us. God, continue to allow us to be as devoted to you as you are to us. Draw us closer by your grace and love us tenderly by your mercy. We give your name the total praise that it is due, and we look to you, the author and finisher of our faith. Lord, allow our devotion to be shown abroad by other men, talked about and praised for the God that you are to us. Thank you for being devoted to us. Thank you for loving us like you do. It's in the powerful, strong, and pragmatic name of Christ Jesus we pray. The people of God shouted together, amen. Well, beloved, that's my time. I thank you for yours. Another week, God has blessed us. New year, new you. I hope to see you at 1140 Pratt Highway on one Sunday, one Wednesday, Tuesday night couples, singles, living single sessions, or catching us out and abroad. Thank you for stopping and letting us know. Hey, you're my pastor online. You're my pastor on the radio. Every Sunday, 98.7 KISS FM at 1130 with Leo Taylor is a phenomenal opportunity for us. So wherever life has you, we want to reach you right where you are and give you the tools that will help you move. I love you to life. Peace. Oh,